formal start time.
Thank you for the introduction and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I will be talking to you today about testing the effects of oxidative stress on genomic recombination and honeybee mellifera. Honeybees are one of the most important crop pollinators known to man. They pollinate millions and millions of dollars worth of crops, and it is well regarded that if the honeybees die off, our crop pollination will our crop production, food production, will drop drastically. But they are also an important model organism for studying several biological processes, including aging, social evolution, phenotypic plasticity, oxidative stress responses, and genomic recombination. They are eusocial, colony-oriented, and biologically divided into three castes: the workers, queens, and drones. The workers gather pollen, nectar, propolis, they build the hive out of wax, they make the honey and the royal jelly, and they protect the queen and the hive. The drones, they mate with queens from other hives, and they don't do much else. They are solely a reproductive caste. The queens are the primary egg layers, and they are the only caste in the honeybees that experiences meiosis. The drone is haploid, so it doesn't produce its sex cells by meiosis, and the workers are functionally sterile. So my study is primarily focusing on the queens and the brood they produce in order to view recombination effects that occur in the queen. The honeybee recombination rate is the highest rate among metasomans. At 19 to 22 sim organs per megabase with a diploid chromosome of 32 chromosomes, a diploid genome of 32 chromosomes, they have about 5 chiasma per homologous chromatids that pair up. The chiasma are these regions, these arms where the homologous chromosomes cross over with each other and swap genetic information. In comparison, most other organisms experience 1 or 2 chiasma per homologous pair. Now, it is thought that eusociality and competition with parasites provide a evolutionary selective pressure to push honeybees towards this high recombination rate in what is known as the red queen hypothesis, where they have to change very fast in order to stay within their biological niche. The molecular cause for this high recombination rate, however, is largely unstudied. There are two types of genomic recombination. There's the meiotic recombination and the double-strand break repair of homologous recombination. Meiotic recombination occurs within prophase 1 of meiosis 1. It ensures proper chromosome segregation and genetic diversity, promotes genetic diversity, and there are many similarities between meiotic recombination and the double-strand break repair pathway of homologous recombination, including shared recombinases and recombination mediator proteins. And they are both triggered by a double-strand break, although meiotic recombination is triggered by a controlled break by SPO11, which is elucidated in the yeast Saccharomyces cerevisiae, whereas double-strand break repair is triggered by a accidental or stress break caused by DNA damage. However, it is because of these shared molecular mechanisms that it could be that double-strand breaks induced through stress during prophase 1 could potentially trigger additional crossover events. Now, I intend to try to induce breaks by using paraquat, which is a model for oxidative stress because it produces reactive oxygen species. Through redox cycling, it produces superoxide. The superoxide gets turned into hydrogen peroxide by superoxide dismutase, and the hydrogen peroxide gets turned into hydroxyl radicals through the Fenton reaction. Hydroxyl radicals can induce strand breakage through a mechanism known as hydrogen abstraction, in which the hydroxyl removes hydrogen atoms from the deoxyribose backbone of DNA, and it will attack any position that is available. And basically what happens is it rips off hydrogen atoms and electrochemically destabilizes the molecule, causing it to more or less break apart at the points where hydrogen abstraction occurs. Now, this does occur on single-strand and in a double-strand fashion if hydroxyl radicals happen to attack both sides of the DNA helix. In the case of the double-strand breaks, it is generally repaired by double-strand break repair. So, because of this, and because of these shared mechanisms between double-strand break repair and mitotic recombination, it is my hypothesis that genomic recombination will be upregulated in response to oxidative stress that takes place during meiosis. And my prediction being that if my hypothesis is true, then the genotyping of paired markers before and after paraquat injection will reveal an increase in recombination in the recombination rate in the offspring of the queen bees. Now, I have injected several queens between the second and third abdominal plates, counting from anterior backwards, in order to get it close to get the paraquat in right next to the ovaries, which are the site of meiosis in the queen bee. And I've kept it consistently on the left side of the queen bees and avoided the aortic arch and the ventral nerve cord. So for my primary sample gathering setup, first of all, the dose that I administered to the queen, the queens, was 1 microliter at 10 micrograms per microliter of paraquat. That seemed to be a good dose to stress them without killing them overnight. So for sample collection, what I would do is I would set up these nuclear hives, and I would collect 200 brood from the queen pre-injection, inject the queen with paraquat, wait 3 weeks, collect another 200 brood, and those would be my cohort, those would be my sample set. Out of the 26 queens I injected, only 11 survived that 3 week waiting period afterwards for brood post-injection. The purpose of the 3 week waiting period was to ensure that all of the already formed eggs that she had during paraquat injection were moved out of the ovaries and out of her egg laying apparatus, and all of the forming eggs during the time of injection to fully develop and become and get laid in the honeycomb, or not the honeycomb, in the brood comb. Now, the brood that I collected, they were submitted to Kelex DNA extraction into 96 well PCR plates marked according to the queen slash hive they were taken from. They were measured by nanodrop and then diluted into PCR ready dilution plates of about 5 nanograms per microliter. I then optimized primer panels for each of the colonies slash queens I took brood from. As you notice, none of the microsatellite markers I used to genotype are polymorphic in all of the colonies slash queens that I collected. So I had to have a different primer panel for every colony. After optimizing my primer panels, I genotyped each of them. The primers were all on chromosome 3 paired primer sets that were designed to be both physically and recombinatorially close to each other for purposes of determining recombination rates. I genotyped them on the LightOR DNA analyzer genotyping platform. Below is a sample picture of an output file for one of my markers. I would label the low band as a, I would look for a pattern in the genotyping. I would look for individuals such as this where single bands. Low band was consistently called A, high band consistently called B, and I would use that to determine genotypes for individual markers and then pair the genotypes for producing intervals. And this is to illustrate recombinatorial positions of markers that I had used and the recombinatorial distance between them. I tried to keep the recombinatorial distances at around 20 centimorgans. The intervals at around 20 centimorgans. My optimal window was between 20 and 60 centimorgans. Now, after doing all the genotyping, I subjected my results. I filed them, subjected them to statistical analysis using GraphPad Quick Calc's free online statistical software, performed a sign test. And what I found was out of 27 interval comparisons, only 13 experienced upregulation, which gave me a one-tail p-value of around 0.5, not statistically significant. I noticed that some of the intervals had higher recombination fraction than realistically expected in the pre-injection set. The expected value came from a third-generation recombination map by Solon and Akinol. And so I tested them again, weeding out those intervals that had a pre-injection value of more than 8% greater or lesser than the expected value. Got 16 intervals, and out of those, only 9 experienced upregulation, with one-tail p-value of 0.401, again, not statistically significant. This is just to illustrate my results. First thing, there is no consistent pattern here. The black bars are the expected value derived from the third generation recombination map. The purple bars are the experimentally obtained recombination rates in the pre-injection sample set, the red post-injection sample set. Each colony slash queen brood were taken from is indicated parentheses and each interval tested. So my hypothesis that genomic recombination would be upregulated in response to oxidative stress is unfortunately not supported by the data I obtained. Negative results though, still results. However, there are a few issues that complicate the data I gathered. For one thing, there are high technical dropouts, partly due to the fact that most of the brood I collected were workers, having two parents and two sets of chromosomes from two different parents. Sometimes the drones, who were the fathers, had an allele that was identical to one of the queen alleles. And so in several individuals, it would appear as though an individual had both queen alleles, so I couldn't call it, it was a technical dropout. That's one thing that reduced the statistical power of my samples. Also, I only tested on chromosome 3. Testing more chromosomes might reveal a more overall trend, genome-wide trend. 3-week waiting period was an estimate for how long it would take for the already formed eggs to get out and the eggs affected by stress to be laid. Maybe it was too long. There are definitely some individual effects that I saw with the pre-injection recombination rate at same intervals being higher in some colonies and lower in others. Also, I would have liked to have done an assay for oxidative DNA damage to ensure that they were significantly stressed, that the DNA had received significant oxidative damage. I have not had time to produce that, unfortunately. However, in all of this, there is still illustrated a greater need for elucidating and studying the molecular mechanisms of recombination in Apis mellifera. I would like to thank my mentor, Dr. Rueppell, members of the Rueppell Lab, my committee members whose input has been valuable in my research, my collaborators at NC State, Dr. Mike Enstrom and Ming Guohang, granting agency NIH, and the supplier at Queens that I use mix of these. Any questions?
Number one question.
Yes?
Has this sort of experiment been tried using parasites or pathogens instead of chemical stimulus to induce recombination?
Not that I am aware of.
Would it be a good idea?
It would be worth trying out. Yes, it is a stressor that could potentially induce stress that leads to the kind of DNA damage that might induce genomic recombination. So it would be worth trying out.